Hello and welcome to Petroleum Bites. Today we're going to talk about perforation. It's one of the important stages in well completion and the main conduit that connects between reservoir and the wellbore. In this video, we'll identify the concept of perforation and what role it plays in well completion. We'll discuss each component that exists in perforation gun and what are the main criteria which are used to pick the optimum gun to meet with the required job objectives. After that, we will briefly mention the operational execution part and how perforation gun is deployed down to the targeted formation depth, highlighting the pros and cons of each method. So let's get started. So what is perforation? After drilling operation to targeted formation depth is reached, usually the well is completed by installing a production liner and performing a cement job. In this moment, the targeted formation is sealed by the cemented liner, and there is no way to get access to the reservoir rock. Here comes the rule of the perforation, as holes are plastered through steel casing, cement, and formation rocks, creating conductive tunnels that allow movement of formation fluid from the reservoir to the wellbore to start production process. Perforation gun consists of a gun housing, which is a metal shroud that provides protection to gun charges during running operation in the wellbore. The gun may have different lengths. It depends entirely on the required interval that need to be open of the formation. The charges contain explosive material, which explode to punch through the casing and create perforation tunnel. Then we have charge carrier, that carries charges in a certain order that accommodates the required job application, which we are going to discuss later on. The detonating cord, which extend along all charges, to deliver detonation signal from the detonator to fire all charges almost instantaneously. Let's have a closer look at shaped charge to know what it's made of. Shaped charge has an outer case shell that houses explosive material, which is held in place by a conical liner. The type of the explosive is determined based on the downhole temperature and the time which explosive will remain under this temperature before executing the perforation job. This will be discussed later on in this video with more details. The igniter that starts the ignition in the explosive after receiving the detonation signal. The liner does more than hold the explosive in place. Its conical shape is being deformed by the explosion to create a high pressure jet of energy, which penetrates through the casing, cement, and formation rock in order to form the perforation tunnel. This is how the charge works. First, the detonation cord delivers the signal to the igniter to start ignition in the explosive. The explosion creates a massive pressure that starts deforming the conical liner to have a form of a jet. The tip speed of the jet achieves a very high velocity that can reach up to 30,000 feet per second, which created massive pressure up to 15 million pounds per square inch. This pressure is high enough to punch through the metal casing cement and create a tunnel through the formation rock. Moving on to another topic, which is the gun and charges specifications. There are five main specifications through which we can select the optimum perforation gun that fits for the required applications. These specifications are the outside diameter size of the gun, the shooting density, the charge phasing, type of the explosives, and finally the entrance hole diameter and the penetration of created perf. Starting with the outside diameter, the gun size is decided based on the inside diameter of the wellbore and the casing through which the gun is running. The gun can normally run inside the casing. However, in some application, it might be needed to run through a tubing string with a much smaller inside diameter. In this case, it's called a through-tubing perforation. So, in this case, the selection of the gun is decided based on the maximum outside diameter that can pass through the minimum inside diameter of the wellbore. There are many sizes of the gun that start from 1/11/16 inches and up to 7 inches gun. Moving on to the next spec, which is the shooting density. It's referred to the number of perforation shot per unit of length, typically measured as shoot per foot or sometimes shoot per meter. The shooting density has a direct effect on flow coming off the reservoir rock. The number of shots is directly proportional to the expected flow rate. The selection of shooting density depends completely on the objective of perforation job, either to maximize flow rate or to limit it. In some operational applications like limited entry hydraulic fracturing or sand production, lower shooting density is highly recommended. Next is the charge phasing. It is the radial distribution of successive perforating charges around the gun axis, or in other words, the angle between successive charges, as shown in the schematic. Phasing selection is crucial, especially in oriented perforation and hydraulic fracturing applications. Perforating gun assemblies are coming available in 0, 180, 120, 90, and 60 degree phasing. The selection of optimum gun phasing depends on the objective of the perforation. There are three types of explosives commonly used in perforation: RDX, HMX, and HNS. RDX stands for Research Development Explosive. HMX is an abbreviation of many expressions, such as High Melting Explosive, or Her Majesty Explosive, or High Molecular Weight Explosive. HNS is an abbreviation of hexanitrile beam. As appears in the chart, selection of explosive type depends entirely on downhole temperature and the required operational time under which the explosive will stay before starting perforation operation. So for longer operational time at high downhole temperature, it's highly recommended to use a high explosive type such as HMX or HNS. Finally, the entrance hole diameter and the penetration of created perforation. This represents the inside diameter of created tunnels and how deep it goes through the rock. Usually, entrance hole diameter ranges from 0.2 to over 1 inch and penetrates from 5 to over 90 inch deep in the rock. There are several ways to deploy a perforating gun in a wellbore. One of the most used method is wireline. This technique has several advantages. For instance, it's operationally fast and can be performed with or without a rig on location, like performing through tubing perforations, which can save rig time and cost. In addition, accurate depth correlation is granted thanks to wireline cable, which provides live communication between the downhole gun and the surface control unit. Downsides of wireline perforating are concentrated on gun length and weight limitations. In addition, challenging accessibility in highly deviated and horizontal wells. Moreover, the need to operate always over balance to ensure well control, which prevents from a proper cleanup of purse and the potential risk of formation damage. Second method is to be by deploying the gun on tubing, which is known as tubing conveyed perforation. ECP. In this method, guns are attached to tubing and run in the well using a drilling or workover rig. TCP guns offer benefits such as the ability to deploy long perforation intervals, in addition to the ability to operate in highly deviated wells. Also, the ability to leave tubing in place after perforating under balance, as it provides better cleanout of perforation tunnels and allow fluid flow to surface immediately after executing perforations. Using this method requires multiple trips into the well, which make it time-consuming and relatively slow. Another drawback to the use of TCP gun is that a drilling or workover rig is required to run the guns into and out of the wells. To run in hole with the gun and fire exactly at target depth, we need to add a logging tool along with the gun string to help locating the exact depth. In this case, gamma ray log can help with locating the targeted depth, as it is usually recorded for each well during the drilling operation. So usually gamma ray detector is deployed with the gun to record the gamma ray for the well across the targeted intervals. After that, we compare the recorded gamma ray with the original one of the well by detecting the shift in depth between them, so we can correct the gun depth and fire exactly at the targeted formation. There are some other logs that can be attached to the gun and help with depth correlation, such as casing color locator (CCL), which identify wellbore anomalies like casing colors, tub of liners, pop joint, or nipples. When it comes to perforation execution operation, there are two conditions under which the job is executed: overbalance and underbalance. Imagine that we have information with a certain reservoir pressure and a wellbore that is filled with a killing fluid that having a hydrostatic pressure. When the wellbore hydrostatic pressure is greater than the reservoir pressure, this condition is known as the overbalance perforation. Overbalance perforation forces the wellbore fluid to go inside the formation. This method is good to the well control perspective, to control any kick that might occur from the formation, especially if the reservoir pressure is unknown. However, on the other hand, it might risk the damage of the reservoir rock, as perforation tunnel is not properly cleaned, in addition to crushed sand and gun debris are kept inside the tunnel, which may affect productivity. When the wellbore hydrostatic pressure is lower than the reservoir pressure, this condition is known as the underbalanced perforation. The pressure difference makes the fluid move from the reservoir to the wellbore, forcing the gun debris and crushed sand to be pushed out of the perforation tunnel and give a better perforation cleanup. However, severe underbalance may cause solid movement and damage in the near wellbore area. There are many correlations and best practices have been done to identify the optimum underbalance value based on the rock permeability. For example, this chart is done by George King, suggests creating underbalance value between 600 and up to 1500 psi, which should yield good results in an oil bearing formation with a range of permeability ranges from 5 to 100 millidarcies. With that, we conclude our lesson today. I hope you enjoyed the video and it was useful to you. If you have any questions or comments, or you want me to present a certain topic, please write it down in the comments. Or you can send me an email on petroleumbytes@gmail.com. Thanks for watching and see you next time.